This is Apollo Saturn launch control. 4 minutes and counting. We are go for Apollo 11. Launch operations manager Paul Donnelly wished the crew on the launch team's behalf good luck and Godspeed. We'll be coming up in the automatic sequence about 10 or 15 seconds from this time. Neil Armstrong reported back when he received the good wishes. Thank you very much. We know it will be a good flight. Firing command coming in now. We are on the automatic sequence. T-minus 3 minutes and counting. T-minus three. We are go with all elements of the mission at this time. We're on an automatic sequence as the master computer supervises hundreds of events occurring over these last few minutes. T-minus 2 minutes, 45 seconds and counting. The members of the launch team here in the control center monitoring a number of what we call red line values. These are tolerances we don't want to go above and below in temperatures and pressures. They're standing by to call out any deviations from our plans. 2 minutes, 30 seconds and counting. We're still go on Apollo 11 at this time. The vehicle is starting to pressurize as far as the propellant tanks are concerned. And all is still go as we monitor our status for it. 2 minutes, 10 seconds, and counting. The target for the Apollo 11 astronauts, the moon, at liftoff will be at a distance of 218,096 miles away. We've just passed the 2 minute mark in the countdown. T-minus 1 minute, 54 seconds, and counting. Our status board indicates that the oxidizer tanks in the second and third stages now have pressurized. T-minus 1 minute, 35 seconds. All indications coming in to the control center at this time indicate we are go. 1 minute, 25 seconds, and counting. Our status board indicates the third stage completely pressurized. 80-second mark has now been passed. We'll go on full internal power at the 50-second mark in the countdown. Guidance system goes on internal at 17 seconds, leading up to the ignition sequence at 8.9 seconds. We're approaching the 60-second mark on the Apollo 11 mission. T-minus 60 seconds and counting.
Three men, two spacecraft, one rocket. Destination, moon. The rocket, a monster tall as a skyscraper, heavy as a Navy destroyer, powerful as a fleet of airplanes. The spacecraft, one named Columbia, to carry the trio into lunar orbit and later bring them safely home. The other, an ungainly, spindly-legged contraption named Eagle, destined to land lunar pioneers on the surface of the moon. And the men, what of them? The flesh and blood component of this incredible complex of hardware and software. Who are they? These lunar astronauts of Apollo 11. All three had been in space before, but to most people, they remained relatively unknown until a news conference in Huston 11 days before liftoff, when they sat in an isolation booth on the stage of the Manned Spacecraft Center's auditorium and fielded questions from reporters. Neil Armstrong, civilian, 38 years of age.
The objective of this flight is precisely to take man to the moon, make a landing there, and return. That is the objective.
Michael Collins, Air Force Lieutenant Colonel, 38 years of age.
Although I'm called the center seat man, in fact, I don't ride in the center seat. I ride in either the right-hand seat for launch or the left-hand seat for the Burns entry and the other major flight plan events.
And Edwin Aldrin, Jr., Air Force Colonel, 39 years of age.
We'll be picking up where the Apollo 10 flight left off when they did their phasing maneuver. And at this point, after departing the command module, coming down in the descent orbit, we'll be igniting the descent engine for the first time under a long burn condition.
A man who knows the Apollo 11 astronauts well, Dr. Thomas Paine, the administrator of NASA, talked about the crew just a short while before the flight.
The Apollo 11 crew, I would characterize as being some of the best and most competent pilots that we've got. I don't think there's an astronaut in the space program that has a greater competence, for example, than Buzz Aldrin. He's a superb pilot. Mike Collins, I would also characterize as being the kind of person, if I were going on a mission myself to the moon, and I certainly would like to, I would certainly feel very good having Mike Collins along with me, and knowing that he was up there in the command module would certainly increase my confidence. Tremendously capable, cool character. As far as Neil Armstrong goes, who at present plans go through, would be the first man to land on the surface of the moon. I think Neil is characterized by a great breadth of competence. Neil has flown about every kind of aircraft that flies. He's flown in the space program now with great distinction, including, you may recall, service in our X series of very advanced aircraft. I think that Neil is an excellent choice for a fella to handle the problems involved in getting out there and being the first man to operate on the moon's surface.
Buttoned into their spacecraft at the top of the Saturn V rocket on pad 39A that morning in July, the three Apollo 11 astronauts waited for the countdown to the moment of truth.
This is Apollo Saturn Launch Control. We are go for Apollo 11. The Apollo mission, the flight to land of the first men on the moon. T-minus 15 seconds. Guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9. Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. 0, all engine running. Liftoff, we have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11. Tower cleared.
Hey, Houston, Apollo 11 and Saturn gave us a magnificent ride.
Roger, 11, we'll pass that on, and it certainly looks like you're well on your way now.
And at this fiery, thunderous instant, the tireless efforts of thousands for over a decade and the dreams of millions throughout the centuries converged as the majestic Saturn V rocket catapulted man into history and mankind into the future. On July 16, 1969, at exactly 9:32 a.m., the heart of the whole world stopped momentarily as three American astronauts, Neil Armstrong, Edwin Aldrin Jr., and Michael Collins, left a world that would probably never again be the same and rocketed across the cosmos toward man's first landing on another celestial body, the moon. The epic journey of Apollo 11 had begun. The next 3.5 days found Apollo 11 soaring through the heavens. And while the feats of man and technology were performed without a flaw, the eyes and ears of the world followed the spacecraft as it was shot into and out of Earth orbit, and then thrust into its lunar trajectory. We marveled as the crew delicately maneuvered the separation and docking of the command module, codenamed Columbia, and the lunar module, the LEM, codenamed Eagle, and then send the remaining stage of the Saturn V rocket into solar orbit. We waited patiently as Apollo 11 coasted for 2 days, confidently homing in on its lunar target, on the third day achieve lunar orbit, and while harnessing lunar gravity, remain in orbit around the moon for the next 24 hours. Finally, on the fourth day, the dramatic separation of Columbia and Eagle as the Apollo 11 mission reaches the threshold of man's most monumental achievement. At approximately 4 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, with Michael Collins orbiting the moon in the Columbia, Neil Armstrong and Edwin Aldrin began the Eagle's descent toward the moon.
Roger, Eagle, sun dot.
Roger, how does it look?
Eagle has wings.
Eagle, Houston, we rig you now. You're a go for PDI, over.
Roger, understand.
We're go, same type, we're go. 60 seconds.
Lights on. 40 feet down, 2.5. Picking up some dust. 30 feet, 2.5 down. Straight shadow. 4 forward. 4 forward, drifting to the right a little. 1.5.
30 seconds.
Forward, just. Okay. Contact light. Okay, engine stop. ATA at a descent.
Auto descent.
Motion control both auto descent engine command override off.
Engine arm off. 413 is in.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Houston, that may have seemed like a very long final phase. The auto targeting was taking us right into a football field sized crater with a large number of big boulders and rocks for about a 1 or 2 crater diameters around it. And it required us flying on a P-66 and flying manually over the rock field to find a reasonably good area.
Sounds good to us, Tranquility. Be advised, there are lots of smiling faces in this room and all over the world, over.
Well, there's 2 of them up here.
Roger, it was a beautiful job, you guys.
And don't forget one in the command module.
Roger.
Now, we'll get to the details of what's around here, but it looks like a collection of just about every variety of shape, angularity, granularity, but every variety of rock you could find. The color is, it varies pretty much depending on how you're looking relative to the drill phase point. There doesn't appear to be too much of a general color at all. However, it looks as though some of the rocks and boulders, of which there are quite a few in the near area, looks as though they're going to have some interesting colors to them, over.
Roger, copy.
Houston, this is Tranquility. We're standing by for a go for a cabin deep breath, over.
Tranquility Base, this is Houston. You are go for cabin depressurization.
Houston,
go for cabin depressurization.
The hatch is coming open.
Okay, Houston, I'm on the porch.
Roger, Neil. And we're getting a picture on the TV. Okay, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
Neil, we can see you coming. I'm at the foot of the ladder, and I'll step off the limb now. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Yes, the surface is fine and powdery. I can pick it up loosely with my toe. It does adhere in fine layers, like powdered charcoal, to the sole and inside of my boots. I only go in a small fraction of an inch, maybe an eighth of an inch, but I can see the footprints of my boots and the treads in the fine sandy particles. It has a stark beauty all its own. It's like much of the high desert of the United States. It's different, but it's very pretty out here.
Now I want to back up and partially close the hatch, making sure not to lock it on my way out. Okay, I'm on the top step, and I can look down over the RCU and landing gear pad. It's a very simple matter to hop down from one step to the next.
Yes, I found it to be very comfortable, and walking is also very comfortable.
There's a slight tendency I can see now to backwards. Due to the soft, very soft texture.
Oh, you're standing on a rock, big rock there now.
I say that the rocks are rather slippery. You have to be careful that you're leaning in the direction you want to go, otherwise you watch at the edge of that crater is
soft. Yeah, soft there, isn't it?
Hey, Neil, didn't I say we might see some purple rocks?
Find a purple rock?
Yep. Neil is now unveiling the plaque.
It says, "Dear men from the planet Earth, first set foot upon the moon, July 1969, AD. We came in peace with all mankind. It has the the crew members' signatures and the signature of the President of the United States.
Yes, indeed. They've got the flag up now, and you can see the stars and stripes on the limit. Neil and Buzz, the President of the United States is in his office now and would like to say a few words to you. Over.
That would be an honor.
Go ahead, Mr. President. This is Huston out.
Hello, Neil and Buzz. I'm talking to you by telephone from the Oval Room at the White House. And this certainly has to be the most historic telephone call ever made. I just can't tell you how proud we all are of what you... For every American, this has to be the proudest day of our lives. And for people all over the world, I am sure they too join with America in recognizing what an immense feat this is. Because of what you have done, the heavens have become a part of man's world. And as you talk to us from the Sea of Tranquility, it inspires us to redouble our efforts to bring peace and tranquility to Earth. For one priceless moment in the whole history of man, all the people on this Earth are truly one. One in their pride in what you have done, and one in our prayers that you will return safely to Earth.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's a great honor and privilege for us to be here representing not only the United States, but men of peace of all nations, and with interest and a curiosity, and with a vision for the future. Honor for us to be able to participate here today.
Thus was history made, and thus was a nation's rendezvous with destiny fulfilled. As John F. Kennedy had said in those long ago days in 1961, before there was a moon program.
Space is open to us now, and our eagerness to share its meaning is not governed by the efforts of others. We go into space because whatever mankind must undertake, free men must fully share.
And now, Apollo 11 is history. And this is not the end, but only the barest beginning. Where do we go from here? Space Administrator Payne has the answer. An answer that must grip the imagination of anyone who has ever wondered what lies over the hill just ahead.
In the short range, we're planning to follow up the Apollo 11 mission with three additional trips to the moon. These will land in highland areas as well as the mare areas. Will land in a configuration on the surface of the moon such that the experiments that we leave behind, and particularly the seismic detectors, will give us a network on the surface of the moon so that we will get more than just the sum of the scientific information back from our stations, but we'll get additional information because of the simultaneous feedback that we can get now from the moon. After the initial Apollo 11 mission, followed by, we hope, three additional landings, we're planning six more, which will go to spots of high scientific interest on the moon. Some of these very fascinating areas which are thought to have exhibited volcanic activity. Some of these areas which seem to bear some evidence that water may once have existed on the surface of the moon. Some of the areas at the bottom of the craters which expose the deep interior of the moon to our view. Areas which are of the maximum scientific interest. On the basis of these, perhaps as many as 10 trips to the moon, we should be able to form a judgment whether in the medium and longer range time we should be thinking in terms of establishing a lunar base. Let me just mention one interest that we have in it. It would give us a remarkably effective site for a radio telescope, which would then have a baseline with radio telescopes on Earth of 240,000 miles, you see. It would give us a wonderful place to explore the early history of the Earth before all of the erosion took place. It gives us an opportunity to explore a planet without an atmosphere, and many other things which I won't go into. Let me move to our medium range plans. We have now, in the planning and preliminary hardware phase, our Apollo application program, which is to use some of our leftover Apollo hardware to produce a prototype, if you like, of a space station. It will be a place where astronauts can operate in a very large container, some 20 feet in diameter, 50 feet long, a place where we can carry out scientific observations using telescopes of the surface of the sun, a place where we can learn many of the things that we have to know before our engineers can design a space station. And then, in the longer range, lies the space station. A space station which would be, in effect, an artificial moon, orbiting several hundred miles above the Earth instead of hundreds of thousands of miles, a place where scientists could go to work in high-energy physics and study particles with energies which we cannot attain with any of the accelerators that have been built here on Earth. Be able to study the stars without the screening of the Earth's atmosphere. Be able to look down at the Earth, at the oceans, at the agricultural lands, at the forests, at the mineral wealth, and all of the things which go into making up the world's weather. Observing all of these from space. And being able to do experiments in the zero gravity and in artificial gravities, which cannot be performed on the surface of Earth. The space station, we feel, is a key to not only man living for long times in space, but also beyond that to travel to the planets. If we can keep men alive for as long as a year or two in space stations, it will be a relatively straightforward matter to put the thrusting devices on it, which will move such a station on out to orbit to Mars and to use lunar landing type devices to reach the surface.
Many steps remain before these long-range goals can be achieved. Apollo 11 was only the first of these steps, but a giant step. To a plane on the moon, where today stands a flat-top monument to man's ingenuity, a monument with an inscription that reads, "Here, men from the planet Earth first set foot upon the moon, July 1969 A.D. We came in peace for all mankind."